Our Bible reading tonight is took from 2 Kings chapter 5, verses 1 to 14. Now Naaman, captain of the host of the king of Syria, was a great man with his master, and honourable, because by him the Lord had given deliverance unto Syria. He was also a mighty man of valour, but he was a leper. And the Syrians had gone out by companies, and had brought away captive out of the land of Israel a little maid, and she waited on Naaman's wife. And she said unto her mistress, Would God, my lord, were with the prophet that is in Samaria, for he would recover him of his leprosy. And one went in and told the Lord, saying, Thus and thus said the maid that is of the land of Israel. And the king of Syria said, Go, and I will send a letter unto the king of Israel. And he departed, and took with him 10 talents of silver, and 6,000 pieces of gold, and 10 changes of raiment. And he brought the letter to the king of Israel, saying, Now, when this letter is come unto thee, behold, I have therewith sent Naaman my servant to thee, that thou mayest recover him of his leprosy. And it came to pass, when the king of Israel had read the letter, that he rent his clothes, and said, Am I God, to kill and to make alive, that this man doth send unto me, to recover a man of his leprosy? Wherefore, consider, I pray you, and see how he seeketh a quarrel against me. And it was so, when Elisha, the man of God, had heard that the king of Israel had rent his clothes, that he sent to the king, saying, Wherefore hast thou rent thy clothes? Let him come now to me, and he shall know that there is a prophet in Israel. So Naaman came with his horses and his chariot, and stood at the door of the house of Elisha. And Elisha sent a messenger unto him, saying, Go and wash in the Jordan 7 times, and thy flesh shall come again to thee, and thou shalt be clean. But Naaman was wroth, and went away, and said, Behold, I thought he would surely come out to me, and stand, and call in the name of the Lord his God, and strike his hand over the place, and recover the leper. Are not Abana and Pharpar, rivers of Damascus, better than all the waters of Israel? May I not wash in them and be clean? So I turned and went away in a rage. And his servants came near and spake unto him and said, My father, if the prophet had bid thee to do some great thing, wouldest thou not have done it? How much rather then would he say to thee, Wash and be clean? Then went he down and dipped himself 7 times in Jordan, according to the saying of the man of God. And his flesh came again like unto the flesh of a little child, and he was clean. We trust the Lord will bless the reading of his precious word to our hearts. And we'd just like to hand back over now to Pastor George for the remainder of the service. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Papa, for sharing with us tonight your testimony. And thank you so much indeed, Sam, also, for reading the word of God for us tonight. I want to begin God's message this evening with a question. And the question is this tonight. Do you believe that God can do the impossible? Do you believe? Can God do the unthinkable tonight? Because in the book of Jeremiah, chapter 32 and verse 27, God makes a very wonderful statement. He says in Jeremiah 32, verse 27, Behold, I am the Lord, the God of all flesh. Is there anything too hard for me? You know, friend, that teaches me tonight that God is the God who can do the impossible, and God is the God who can do the unthinkable. Do you remember what the angel told Abraham when he told Abraham that he was going to have a son in a certain time of that year? And you remember Abraham was 99 years of age, and you remember Sarah, she was past childbearing, for she was 90. What did the angel say to Abraham? He says, Is there anything too hard for the Lord? You see, friend, tonight, my God is the God that can do the impossible. And my God is the God who can do the unthinkable. Because the Lord Jesus backs that theory up tonight and that great truth up this evening. He says, with men it is impossible, but all things are possible with God. And my dear friend tonight, I want you to understand that great truth tonight. God can do the impossible and God can do the unthinkable. Isn't that wonderful tonight, just to know that God can do something wonderful? Well, there's a man in our Bible reading tonight who needed God to do the impossible. He needed God to do the unthinkable. And you know, friend, when God does the unthinkable tonight, friend, God can make a real difference. You see, in our Bible reading tonight, we've come to a man who's called Naaman. And mind you, Naaman was a great man and he was a powerful man. He was a powerful man because he was captain over the king's armies. And then we also read here that he not only was he had a great power, but he had a great position too, because we read that he was a great man with his master and honourable, because by him the Lord had given deliverance unto Syria. And you know, friend, Naaman was a great man, you know. He was a man with great power, a man with great position, and he was a man with great potential as well, because it says he was a mighty man in valour. But he also was a man tonight who had a great problem, because the verse 1 ends with these words, but he was a leper. Here is a man called Naaman tonight, and for a period in his life, life couldn't have been any better, until the day came he discovered that he had this awful disease called leprosy. Leprosy, you see, in the days of Naaman, was like having the worst kind of cancer that could never be cured. It was having the worst type of COVID-19 that we're talking about today that cannot be cured. And Naaman needed a miracle. And you see, when Naaman discovered that he had this leprosy, I'm sure there was many questions that ran through Naaman's mind. I wonder, did he say to himself, I wonder how long I've got left to live. I'm sure there was many a sleepless night he lay in bed thinking, here's me and look where I am. I thought I would grow into an old man. I would see my children grow up. I would have and see my own grandchildren. But that's very unlikely to happen now, he thought, would have thought within himself. You know, Naaman, with this awful leprosy, was a man who needed God to do the impossible for him. But the big problem with Naaman, like so many in our world today, he didn't know anything about God. He didn't know that there was a God who could do the unthinkable. He didn't even know that there was a God who could do the impossible. And you know, friend, Naaman not only had a great problem, but he had a wonderful privilege. Because working for Naaman's wife, there was a wee lady, a wee maid. She's known as the little maid. And she was the little girl who said to her mistress, in verse number 3, said to her mistress, would God, my Lord, were with the prophet that is in Samaria, for he would recover him from his leprosy. You know, in Naaman's household, there was a wee girl. She was the little maid. And here is a little maid who believed in the presence of God and who believed in the person of God and believed in the power of God. Here was a wee girl who knew enough about God that God could do the unthinkable for Naaman and God could do the impossible. Poor Naaman was dying with this leprosy tonight. Here's Naaman, and he's a dying man. He's beyond all human hope. There's not a thing a man could do for this man as he slowly decays and dies with this awful disease. But you know, friend, every one of us was born with a spiritual leprosy. And this is called sin, and every one of us was born with sin. And as leprosy was bringing death to Naaman, so sin brings spiritual death to all those who don't have their sins forgiven. As leprosy was bringing death to Naaman, so sin brings spiritual death for those who have never been to the Lord Jesus and who have never trusted him as their Saviour. And this little maid in Naaman's household tells her mistress to tell Naaman to get him to the prophet in Samaria. His name was Elisha, and he was a man who was in touch with God. Now she knew that this prophet, this man of God, couldn't actually heal him, but God through him could heal him. Do you know, that's what we need today. We need people like Elisha, men who are in touch with God. And we need people like this little maid who know and believe in the power and in the person of God. Naaman, he packs up his bags and the king of Syria sends him off. But you know, Naaman made an awful mistake, because instead of going to the prophet, he goes to the king of Israel. And when he arrives at the king of Israel's house, then he suddenly realizes he's made a terrible mistake. But when we see Naaman in this terrible condition, coming and standing at the house of Elisha the prophet, you know, there's a number of things God wants us to see tonight. First of all, he wants us to see tonight the invitation given to the man. You know, there's a lovely little picture and there's a lovely little scene just here. When the messenger goes into Elisha, Elisha says in verse number 8, "Let him now come to me." You know, that's a wonderful invitation. Let him now come to me. Notice the liberty in those words. Let him come to me. Do you know, in those days when anybody approached you and came near you with leprosy, you wouldn't have went near them, friends. You'd have run a mile, because you see, it was so contagious. But leprosy, here's this man covered in leprosy, and the invitation just simply says, let him come now to me. It's just like somebody coming to you, dear friend, full of COVID-19. And friend, to say to him, let him now come to me. It was unheard of. Friend, in the days of Naaman, you'd dirt have went next or near a man with leprosy. And here this man of God simply says, let him now come to me. You know, friend, I love this invitation because there's the liberty of the invitation. You know, friend, I love the way Elisha treated this man. Elisha treated him with open arms. In spite of his disease, in spite of his condition, Elisha, the man of God, invited him to come. It's the same tonight with the gospel invitation. There's a liberty with the gospel invitation. Because God says to you tonight, in spite of your sin, of or who you are, or what you've done, you can come to me. You see, friend, the Lord Jesus said, I haven't come to call the righteous to repentance. I have come to call sinners to repentance. Those people whose lives are broken. Those people whose lives are in ruins because of sin. I have come to call them to repentance. And I have come to call them to myself. You see, lepers, away back in the days of Naaman, they were treated like outcasts. They were filthy. Nobody wanted them. But you know, friend, even though this man was covered in leprosy, the invitation was given, let him now come to me. You know why I don't like religion, friends? Because religion is so false. Religion would say to you tonight, you can't come until you clean yourself up. You can't come until you get yourself in line. But you know, friend, when you listen to the gospel invitation simply says, just you come the way you are. And maybe that's what God is saying to you tonight. You come the way you are. Maybe tonight your life is in shatters. Your life has been wrecked and ruined by sin. Maybe your very marriage and your home and your family's broken and it's in pieces and it's in shatters tonight. It's all shattered because of something that you've done. And you're living with regret. Well, the Lord Jesus says, you come to me. And you know, friend, that's what I love about the Lord Jesus tonight. Because he has declared there's nobody bad enough that they cannot come. Old religion says you're not good enough to come. But you know, the Lord Jesus says you're not bad enough that you can't come. And maybe you're sitting there now. And friend, humanly speaking, there can nothing be done. You've tried this, you've tried that, and you've tried the other thing. You know there's an invitation that's coming from heaven right to your very heart now. Through my voice, God is saying, let him or her, whoever you may be, now come to me. And I want you to notice the not only the liberty of the invitation, I want you to notice the limit of the invitation. Because the servant of God says, let him now come to me. I love the way this all works out, because what he's saying, listen, don't let the man stand there. Don't let him wait any longer. Let him come now. And my friend, God's not asking you to wait till you feel something, wait till you clean yourself up a bit. The Lord is saying to you, come now. Do you remember what he said in Isaiah chapter 1 verse 18? Come now, let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. And you know, my dear friend tonight, in spite of your sin and in spite of what you've done with your life, God's giving you an invitation tonight. Let him or her, whoever you may be, now come to me. And you see, friend, here's Naaman tonight, and he's covered from head to toe with this terrible leprosy. What a wonderful invitation was given to the man. Do you hear? Did you get it? Let him now come to me. And then the second thing we want to see is the instruction to the man. In verse number 10 we read, it says here, in Elisha. And Elisha sent a messenger unto him, saying, go and wash in Jordan 7 times. I want you to notice the simplicity of the instruction. I want you to notice the simplicity of it. Go and wash 7 times in Jordan. That's all this man had to do. And I want you to notice the surety of the instruction as well, because it says, and thy flesh shall come again to thee, and thou shalt be clean. It was simple, it was as plain and as clear as that. Naaman, go you down to the river Jordan and wash 7 times there, and your skin will come again, and ye shall be clean. The instruction was so simple. Even the youngest child could understand that. My dear friend, if you and I were covered in leprosy and we were dying without hope and there was no hope whatsoever, and the man of God told us to go and do it, what would you have done? I'll tell you what I'd have done. I would have run like mad and I would dive into the River Jordan head first to get rid of the leprosy. You know, friend, tonight, but there was something not right with this invitation or this instruction as far as Elisha was concerned. You see, I just want to pause for a wee moment. Let me tell you tonight about the gospel invitation and the gospel instruction. Do you know what God wants to say to you tonight? If you want your sins forgiven and you want your heart made white in the sight of God and you want a home in heaven, this is what you must do. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you shall be saved. Friend, it's as simple as that. The Lord Jesus says, listen, by me, I am the door. By me, if any man enters in, he shall be saved. Friend, it's that simple. It's that sure tonight. But then not only do I see the invitation and the instruction, I see the illusion of the man. Because in verse number 11, but Naaman was wroth and went away and said, behold, I thought. Do you know there's a lot of people has their own illusions and has their own mind and things. You tell them about something so simple, and yet they said, oh, no, not at all. Not, no, it's like Naaman. Naaman says, this man's telling me to go and jump into the River Jordan and to wash myself seven times the River Jordan. Did you ever hear the like of it? I thought the man would come out and he would put his hands on me and he would call upon his God and do some sort of exorcism upon me, and there would be a bolt of lightning coming from the sky. Do you know what he told me? He goes to the servant. Do you know what he said? Go and wash in Jordan seven times. Did you ever hear the like of it? And you know, friend, there's so many tonight, just like Naaman, they cannot accept the simplicity of the gospel. They're just like Naaman. Are you like Naaman tonight? Listen, if you tell people tonight to take off their shoes and climb mountains and do somersault handstands and cartwheels up and down the road, get on their hands and knees and crawl from one end of the country to the other, friend, they'll be at it wholesale. Because they think, and they have this illusion in their mind, that they have to do some great thing in order to win God's favour. Listen, do you know how to do how to obtain God's favour? Do you know how to do it? Do you know how to get it? Do you know how you can get God to do the unthinkable for you? Just take him at his word and obey it. And you know, friend, if you want God to do the unthinkable for you, if you want God to do the impossible for you, you must obey what he says and get every other illusion out of your mind. But you know, Naaman had wise friends. It's good to have wise friends. And Naaman, he had wise friends. And he said, listen, Naaman, if that man had told you to do some difficult thing, would you not have done it? And Naaman, he started to argue, and he says, but sure, there's better rivers than the River Jordan. There's this river and there's that river, and they're cleaner and they're better. And look at this Jordan River. It's muddy, it's dirty, it's filthy. And he's asking me to go and wash in Jordan, the most filthiest river in the land. But his friends just said to him, listen, do what the man says. Do what he says. And friend Naaman just paused for a wee moment and he began to think about this. And maybe my friends are right. Maybe this is what I should do. You know, maybe in recent days you've been thinking about your soul. You've been thinking yourself about sin. You've been thinking about death and eternity. You've been thinking about God in recent days, and perhaps somebody somewhere has been speaking to you about the love of God and your need of Christ and your need of salvation. And tonight, as we come to this broadcast, God is confirming to you what your friends are telling you, or what you have read is so true. Because you see, friend, tonight, the gospel is that simple. And it's that sure tonight. Because the Lord Jesus did say, except a man be born again, he cannot enter into the kingdom of heaven. And friend, this evening, hear this man covered in leprosy, dying beyond human help, beyond human hope, begins to listen and begins to learn that the man of God might be right. And then I want you to not only notice the invitation and the instruction and the illusion, I want you to notice finally tonight the intervention. Because down in verse number 14 we read, then went he down, do you know he obeyed the voice of the man of God, and dipped himself seven times in Jordan, according to the saying of the man of God. You see, he finally obeys the instruction. And it says this tonight, that he dipped himself seven times. He fully, completely obeyed the man of God's instruction. Friend, because he fully and completely obeyed the man of God's instruction, then God intervened and God done the unthinkable. Friend, tonight, I know tonight that the Jordan River was the most filthiest river in those days in that land. The waters were muddy. It was so unclean. And you know, friend, the Jordan River speaks to us of the cross. There's nothing clean about the cross. In fact, the cross was something that was a symbol of shame and sin. And yet, friend, on an old rugged blood-stained cross, God sent his Son to suffer and to bleed and to die for you. And friend, I'm not sending you to a river tonight. I want to send you to the cross. And as God intervened through the waters of the Jordan River and done the unthinkable for Naaman, God wants to intervene for you this evening through the finished work of the cross. Because that's how you must come tonight. And it's to there where you must come just as you are. And what you'll soon discover, that through the cross, God will do the unthinkable and the impossible for you. You see tonight, the blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, has the power tonight to cleanse you from all sin. And you know, friend, God's saying to you tonight that you must repent of your sin. That's the big thing tonight. You must repent of your sin. You must turn away from that sinful life that you're living. You cannot just go on in the life that you're living and expect God to do the unthinkable in pardoning your sin and saving your soul. No, you have to, first of all, obey the Lord on those grounds. There must be repentance and turning away from your sin. And then secondly, then you must receive Christ into your heart by faith. Because in Paul's letter to the Ephesians, chapter number 2, verse 8 and 9, we read these words. This is how you're saved. For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. And you know, friend, when Naaman went down into the waters of the Jordan River and obeyed the instruction that the man of God told him, then God intervened in his grace and took away his leprosy and took him away from him, that awful disease. Because of his obedience, God intervened in his grace and gave that man a new skin and gave him a new heart. And friend, he comes out of the Jordan River a different man than what he did when he went into it. And you know, friend, if you come to the cross tonight just the way you are, in repentance of sin, God will intervene for you and will do the unthinkable and take away that sin and give you not only a new skin, he'll give you a new heart and he'll give you a new life. When Naaman come up out of the river, he come up out of the river Jordan a new man, with new skin, with a new heart. And friend, if you come to the cross tonight in repentance of your sin and receive Christ into your heart, friend, God will do the impossible. God will do the unthinkable for you. And friend, tonight, you could begin with being a new man or a new woman, with a new life and with a new heart. Oh, yes, friend. Do you know what Naaman discovered that day? That the God of Israel, the God of heaven, is the God that still doeth wonders. He's the God that doeth the unthinkable. He's the God tonight that doeth the impossible. And do you see, when God does the unthinkable, when God does the impossible, your life will never be the same again. And friend, what a day it was for Naaman, this dying, poor, pathetic creature of a man. What a discovery he made when the day when God intervened for him, when he obeyed the command and dipped himself 7 times in the Jordan River, Friend, tonight, this could be you if you only come to Him in repentance of your sin and trust the Savior. You see, friend, tonight, here's how I want to close. It is no secret what God can do. What He's done for others, He will do for you. With arms wide open, He will welcome you. It is no secret what God can do. A wee story, and I'm going to finish. A preacher of the gospel and a man who manufactured soap was walking down the street one day. And the manufacturer of the soap said to the preacher of the gospel, "I can't understand why you preach the gospel." "Why is that?" said the preacher of the gospel. "Well," he says, "take a look at our world today. Look at the lives of people, how miserable they are, how broken in sin they are. And take a look at how evil and wicked mankind is. It just proves that your gospel doesn't work." The preacher of the gospel didn't say a thing. But I'll tell you what he did do. He just walked on with the man. And they came to a little garden where children were playing in mud, making mud pies. And the children, every one of them, was covered in mud. They had mud all over their faces, over their hands, over their clothes. Oh, they were in an awful condition. And the preacher of the gospel said to them, to the manufacturer of soap, he says, "I see your soap's not making much of a difference." "Why, what do you mean?" he said. He says, "So take a look at them children. Look at their hands, look at their face, look at their clothes." He says, "Your soap has made no difference for them children." And the manufacturer of the soap turned round to the preacher and says, "Listen, for goodness sake, have a bit of sense. It means they haven't applied it. You see, once they apply my soap, man, they'll be white as snow." The preacher of the gospel said, "Well, that's what's wrong with people today. They haven't applied the gospel to their own lives." My friend, the moment you apply the gospel to your life, and the moment you trust Christ as your Savior, friend, that will make a difference. And you see, when God does the impossible, like He did for Naaman, friend, I'll tell you, your life will never be the same again. Let's burn a wee word of prayer. Just now, where you're sitting, I want you to bow your head and close your eyes. And I want you to make this your prayer tonight, if you're really serious and in business concerning this matter of salvation tonight. Let's burn a wee word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, tonight we thank You for Your great love. That, Lord, in spite of what is going on and who we are, we thank You, Lord, that You love us. And so, Lord, tonight I just simply pray that You will indeed, Lord, take me as I am. And I pray, Lord, tonight that I come to You in repentance of my sin. And I ask You tonight, Lord Jesus, to come into my heart to be my Lord and Savior. To do the unthinkable, Lord, for me. I want You to change my life. I want You to take away my sin. I want You to save my soul. I want You, Lord, to really cleanse me and make me a new person. And Lord, what You did for Naaman, I pray You'll do for me in the spiritual sense. I want to be a new person, Lord. I want to live for You. I want, Lord, to be in heaven. I want my sins forgiven. And Lord, I want my life to be controlled and governed by You. And so, Lord, I ask You to please save my soul. Come into my heart. Lord, I pray that from this very moment, that, Lord, You will just, Lord, take over my life. And, Lord, I pray that You indeed will give me that wonderful assurance that I am now Your child. And, friend, tonight, if you've prayed that prayer, I would love you to get in touch with me. Please send me an email as soon as you can. Let me know all about it, and we'll be in touch. I'll be waiting for it. I'll be waiting for it. And I pray that you will do that. And friend, I'll help you in any way I can. And please do it, friends, won't you? Please do it. Heavenly Father, I bring this broadcast before You now. And Lord, as we bring it to a close, I turn the eternal issues of this broadcast to You, praying that this broadcast will be the means of bringing many to Christ tonight. And that, Lord, indeed, many will be cleansed from their sin and made new creatures in the Lord Jesus Christ. Because it's in His name we pray. Amen. And amen. Now, friends, if you have prayed that prayer tonight, please do get in touch. Please send us the email. We'll be waiting on it. And we'll answer it as soon as we can. And friend, tonight, this could be the night when God wants to do the impossible for you and with you. God bless you tonight, friends. And we're going to finish with a lovely hymn that simply says, I hear thy welcome voice that calls me, Lord, to thee. God bless everyone, and may the Lord have his hand upon you in the week that is coming. Thank you.
Wash me, cleanse me in thy blood.